prestigious world-class institution is that I meet the best and the brightest. Academics, faculty, students, staff, researchers, people that come through our halls are like literally the creme de la creme, the 1%, the academic 1% of the world. And in my time and work with them, I'm just going to share a few pieces of reflection with you. And I say this very deliberately in that this is, you know, I visited the Bay Area before, I realized that this is in the proximity to the Bay, to Silicon Valley, and you have many, many Muslim professionals, specialists that work in tech and related fields, mashallah. So this is the best and the brightest in that sense, right? The best the Muslim community has to offer with their respective specialties in this epicenter on this coast, shall we say. And so hopefully there's some points of intersection is what I'm trying to allude to. And what I say to my students is what I'll share with you, which is that two things that we need to recognize. That it is the fadl of Allah, it is the grace and the karam, the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His infinite wisdom, right, in His hikmah, that He has brought us to these lands, right, to do the work that we do, in the places that we work, in the neighborhoods that we reside in, and to engage with the Muslim and non-Muslim community that we engage with. And with that privilege comes responsibility. So the privilege is that we have certain lifestyles, we have certain training, we have certain access, we have certain influence to do certain things, to make things sort of emerge and happen and be a part of the conversation, because you know better than I do, of the seven billion people on this earth, and the 1.7 billion Muslims that Allah has put on this earth, Allah has chosen you to be here, He's chosen me to be where I am. This is a part of our aqidah, right? Allah selects the people to be. You are where He wants you to be at this very moment. The work that you do, the neighborhood you're in, the community that you're a part of, the networks that overlap, that you interface with, was all destined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first thing that I tell my students is the acceptance of this. With the acceptance of that privilege, because how many other of our brethren, of our brothers and sisters from around the world, if they looked at the outside, everyone's life is complicated. My life is complicated. Your life is complicated. Your community has issues. My community has issues. But if people from the outside were to look at our lives, how many of them wouldn't say that they wanted to be here? Right? That if I was there, I would do this, I would do that. So with that, the point that I'm trying to drive home is the appreciation for the ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you here. And I don't just mean in material wealth and material resources, although for many of us that's the starting point, right? Alhamdulillah, I have a roof over my head. Alhamdulillah, I have food to eat in my fridge. Alhamdulillah, I have comfortable living standards for the car that I drive, the house that I live in, the zip code that I reside in, and whatnot. But that's the starting point. Our imagination needs to take us further. That beyond the material comforts that I enjoy, it's the opportunities that Allah has given me. Opportunities for me to recognize my potential through my hard work, the skills and competencies that I've worked through diligently with the faculties that Allah has given me. Allah gave me the ability to go to a school, to get an education, to get a graduate education, to have some of the best teachers in deen as well as dunya. To have the best mashayikh, right, spiritual teachers and guides and mentors and asatida for my spiritual religious life as well as in my dunyawi life, right, in my professional existence. To get degrees and accreditations and whatnot. What I'm saying is, and then we go beyond that, in that the privilege that Allah gives us to be, we have to acknowledge, we have to grapple with this fact. We reside in the locus of power in the world stage. Like, literally, America is the mover and shaker, shall we say, of the economic, political, social, intellectual, cultural affairs of the world. Right. So the idea there is if you drop a stone in a body of water and the ripple effect that goes out, well, there's a very big stone that's being dropped by American influence, cultural, political, military, technological, and whatnot. And then the ripples that radiate outward from that, you and I are part of, whether or not we acknowledge it. So what I invite my students to say is you just need to own it. You need to acknowledge that you're in a place of power and privilege. But then the second question is, what are you going to do with it? For every ni'mah that Allah gives us, there has to be a accounting for it, hisab. So we think of the powerful hadith in which it said the saying that Abu Bakr Siddiq was sitting after the death of the Prophet and he was eating food and he became quiet and he was with his companions, with the ashab, May Allah be pleased with all of them. And he became very quiet and he began to weep. And one of his companions asked, Ya Khalifa Rasulullah, what brings you to tears? Why do you cry? And he said, I remember the time I was with Rasulullah, with the best of creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I was sitting in his majlis, at his table, at his ma'idah, eating with him. And he said, Ya Abu Bakr, oh my friend Abu Bakr, Allah Ta'ala will ask you about each and every one of these blessings that it sends to you. And then the Prophet became quiet, and I became quiet. And this is over a morsel of food. And I want you to imagine every single day how many times you eat, how many delicious morsels of food, nutritious, healthy, life-giving morsels, and the company that we share with the people that live in our lives every day. Manifold, untold blessings that we share every day, and to live our lives with consciousness. And I'm talking at a physical, physiological level, to start with sugar there. But when you start with sugar there, like I talked about the metaphor of the radiating, ripples that come outward, then our heart and our mind should then go, just not only are my material comforts something that I do sugar for to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything else He's given me. And then I have to dig deep and ask myself, what is it that I'm doing with this? What is it that I'm doing here? And I don't want to speak on behalf of your community, but may I just put out there for your consideration to think, I live and work in proximity to the Bay, or in the Bay. The organizations, the institutions, the people, right, that live in this area, the influence that they have, what's my engagement with them, and how am I going to take it seriously to not only serve myself, right? We have enough, and there's an aspect of I need to make my life comfortable, but to have a broader vision. And this is the brilliance of what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught to the companions. Not only did he take them from darkness into the light, the nur of Nubuwwah, the light of Nubuwwah, but winning over their hearts, winning over their minds, and bringing people like Abu Sufyan, who were the elite, the cultural, political, social elite of that society, to the people like Bilal radiallahu anhu, and to the people like Abu Dharr Ghifari radiallahu anhu, at the opposite ends of the spectrum, shall we say, or not spectrum, but of the hierarchy, and to give them a vision of who they were, and not only who they were, but what they could do, what they could give to the world. And I want to honor the time, but I just want to end. I mean, there's so many stories to end from the lives of the Sahaba. One that I'll simply share with you. This is one that I share with my students, right? We live in an era of activism. It's important to acknowledge that. It's important to have very deep, thoughtful, and critical conversations about the Muslim voice in the activism that we see. Political activism, social activism, economic justice, and all of that. But what I'm trying to get at right now is, perhaps one time is better than to talk about the rule of Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu. And with that, I'm going to conclude, inshallah. I want to be as respectful of your time as I can. We've all heard the beautiful, powerful story of Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu. Bilal was literally a slave in that society. He was a man whose physical body was abused and tortured and oppressed by the Kufar of Quraysh, by the Mushrikeen. And the Prophet would see this day in and day out in the early days of the Meccan Seerah, and it would tear him apart. So much so that when he would go to Darul Arqam, and he would go, and the companions, like Sayyidina Abu Bakr, were there, the early companions, the great companions, he would say, can't anyone do anything? And one day, one fateful day, guess who stands up? Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq al-Dhamu stands up. And he says, Ya Rasulullah, I'll take care of it. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq goes to Umayy ibn Khalaf. Umayy ibn Khalaf was the owner, he was one of the worst of the Mushrikeen in Mecca. And he goes to him and he says, I'll buy this man from you. I'm truncating the story in the interest of time. He says, I'll buy this man from you. He begins to laugh. Umayy ibn Khalaf cackles, they say, right? He has this horrible, evil laugh. He says, why do you want this man? He goes, that's none of your business. Just, what do you, name your price and I'll pay him. I'll pay that price for him. He says, okay, give me 10 gold coins, 10 gold pieces. And saying, well, there's a way here, he goes home, he comes back with a pouch and has 10 pieces of gold in it, and he hands it to him. As he's handing it to him, he says, Umayy ibn Khalaf says to him, he goes, you're a fool. You lost out on the deal. You didn't bargain with me. He goes, you don't know what you're getting here. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr says to him, you're the fool. You don't know what you're selling to me. The value of this man is such, if you had asked me for 100 pieces of gold, I would have given you 100 pieces of gold. Because you don't understand the value of this man in the eyes of the Rasul of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the story continues. Through all the stories of torture that he unbelievably went through. Now, Bilal is a free man. So the Prophet gives him two extraordinary responsibilities. The first is, he makes him in charge of Bayt al-Mal. Bayt al-Mal is what? The public treasury. What message is that sending to the Meccan society, to the Quraysh, that I'm taking a man that days ago was an enslaved at the bottom of your hierarchy, and I'm elevating him. Not only elevating him, I am making him, you know, the minister of finance. Like, this is the man that literally controlled the finances of the Rasul of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What message is that sent to that society to take that who is most marginalized and to put him at the top of the food chain, so to speak? And all I'll say is this. I come, you know, I'm by New York, by Wall Street, right? We live in a time now where even talking about business ethics in school of management classes is like an oxymoron. You know, what are the ethics in our finance today? What does it say? But the Prophet taught us, you take the most trustworthy of people, and those are the people that you put in charge of your finance. And then I'll let you fill in the blanks on where we are today as a society. But what else does the Prophet do? He tells Bilal to become the wazir, to be the man that's tasked with and charged with the responsibility of waking up the best of creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for his tahajjud, for his fajr, which is his lifeline, right, as we would say. The connection, the ta'alluq that the Prophet had with his Lord was the nights that he prayed. And he said, Bilal, you're the one that's going to wake me up. Think of the religious responsibility that he's given to Sayyidina Bilal. Then what happens? Bilal is more than the Prophet, and there are, we could spend all day talking about the falah and the virtues of Bilal. His footsteps are heard in Jannah by the Prophet. He's a man that many gifts to us are given through the extraordinary work of Sayyidina Bilal. I just want to focus on one last thing. The Prophet dies on the 12th of Rabi'ul Awwal. When the Prophet dies, we know the story. That itself is a powerful story that needs a whole khutbah. What happens? How does Sayyidina Ali respond? How does Sayyidina Uthman respond? How does Sayyidina Umar respond? And then how does Sayyidina Abu Bakr respond? But the point of the story is this. The Prophet dies in the hujra of Sayyidina Aisha. It's in the morning, the act between Fajr and Dhuhr. The time for Dhuhr comes. Sayyidina Abu Bakr has now started to prepare the body for the janazah. Sayyidina Abu Bakr says to Bilal, Bilal called the Adhan. There's a place if you go to Medina Manora, even today, if you're facing a Qiblah, it's to the back right, it's called Muhammad Bilal. That's where Bilal would give the Adhan from. Bilal is standing there and he goes to give the Adhan. When he gets to Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, when he gets to Ashhadu Anna Muhammad Rasulullah. You know what happened? When he would get to Ashhadu Anna Muhammad Rasulullah, out of the left corner of his eye, the Prophet would walk out of his house and walk to Musalla. He gets to Ashhadu Anna Muhammad Rasulullah, and the Prophet doesn't walk out. Bilal can't go on. His voice cracks. He says, I can't finish. One of the companions finishes the Adhan. After a few days, Bilal goes to Abu Bakr. He says, Ya Khalifa Rasulullah, I'm done. I'm leaving. Abu Bakr is leaving. He says, Khalifa. He says, what are you talking about? He says, I can't stay here. It's too painful. He says, I'm gone. He says, Bilal, didn't I free you? And he says, you freed me. But if you freed me for Allah, then know that I'm a free man. If you freed me for yourself, this is delusion. And Abu Bakr says, I'm not going to stop you. Bilal now leaves Medina Manawara. He goes to the frontier. He goes all the way to Bilal al-Sham. During the time of Sayyidina Umar, there's a fatah of Quds. May Allah bless us with another fatah of Quds. Ameen. When he's there, Sayyidina Umar arrives with the Mujahideen in Quds. What happens? Sayyidina Umar says, where's Bilal? Bilal is brought. Sayyidina Umar says to Bilal, you were honored to give the Adhan in Haramain, in Mecca and in Medina. Now give it in Bayt al-Maqdis. Bilal gets there and begins to give the Adhan. When he gets to Ashhadu Anna Muhammad Rasulullah, his voice cracks. They say that Sayyidina Umar's beard was soaked with tears, and he fell to the floor. They picked him up when it was time for Salah. They said to the Sahaba that their beards were black. When Bilal was a freed man, their beards were now gray from age. And Bilal says, I'm leaving again. He goes to Damascus. and he lived in Damascus for a long time. Now, the end of the story is this, and I realize I'm cutting it very close. My apologies. Bilal now sees the Prophet in the dream. The Prophet says, "Ya Bilal, why don't you visit me?" And Bilal wakes up in a startle at the time of Fajr. And he goes to his wife. He says, I gotta go. So where are you going? He says, I'm going to see Habibullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He goes on his horse from Damascus, hundreds of miles south, and he arrives in Medina Manawara. When he arrives into the old city of Medina, when he walks into the city of Medina Manawara, who does he see? He sees Sayyidina Hussein radiallahu anhu, who was a young boy when he left, and now he's a grown man. And Hussein sees Sayyidina Bilal, and is overjoyed. He says, Ya Ammu, oh my uncle, won't you come into my grandfather's house and give the adhan? And Bilal says to him, I swore I would never give the adhan again, but for the beloved of my beloved, I will. How can I turn down this request? So Sayyidina Bilal goes to the masjid of the Prophet, the masjid of the Nabi, to the maqam that he had before. And he begins to say the adhan. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. It said, Imam Malik releases, that the streets of Medina poured open with people. Because when the people heard the adhan of Bilal, there was such a powerful emotional connection between the adhan of Bilal and the presence of the best Rasulullah, that the people ran out of their houses crying, thinking that the Prophet had come back. And they came into the masjid. And when Bilal went to Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, he fainted. He gave the adhan, he finished the adhan, he finished the prayer. He went and he just sat on the grave of the Prophet and cried. And then he went home. The end of the story is, Sayyidina Bilal, shortly thereafter, was very sick. He was on his deathbed and he was smiling. And his wife said, what are you doing? You're smiling. We see the pain on your body. What are you going to smile about? He says, it's the day of happiness. What are you talking about, a day of happiness? He says, this is the day I'm going to my friends. And he passed away that morning. And all of that I want to leave you with is this. These were people that understood purpose. These were people that understood opportunity. These were people that understood their vision. Allah gave them a task. Allah gave them a chance. Allah gave them a place. Allah gave them a responsibility. And they stepped up to take care and do what needed to be done. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He uses us wherever we are, here, there, wherever we are. You are where Allah wants you to be. And it's my job and it's your job to figure out why we're there and what we're going to do about it. May Allah forgive us for our sins. May Allah accept all the efforts of this community and all of the communities of the beloved of Rasulullah. May Allah have mercy on us. May Allah ease the pain and suffering of all of those who are in pain and suffering around the world. May Allah use us to be at the vanguard of the ummah of our beloved Nabi Kareem, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما بعد فيا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقوا أنفسكم نارا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر لي ولكم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الأمين أما بعد يا معاشر المسلمين قال تعالى في كتاب الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلم تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا مولانا محمد المبارك وسلم اللهم صل على جميع الانبياء والمرسلين وعلى سائر الصحابه والتابعين وعلى عباد الصالحين اللهم اعجنا من النار اللهم اعجنا من النار اللهم اعجنا من النار ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنه حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة طمأنينة عذاب النار عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يعمل بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون وأقيموا الصلاة